Hi friends, today we will study about food irradiation. This lecture will also be conducted in two parts. Part 1 will cover about the again process principles and technological aspects of food irradiation, whereas the second part of the lecture, that is the lecture 16, will cover the effect of food irradiation on the constituents and characteristics of the food, as well as it shall also take up some application aspect, that is what are the different types of food where these irradiation treatments can be done. You know, hope that there are several radiation types which have the characteristic ability to ionize individual atoms or molecules, thereby producing an electron and a positively charged ion. As you could see in this figure, there is one high energy photon is bombarding on this atom, and there is an electron which receives the energy and then it gets ejected from the orbital. And obviously, accordingly, that a positively charged, that is the molecule or atom, is formed and an electron is produced. This symbol shows the symbol of the irradiation, and the photon is then moved forward with the reduced energy. In fact, this is the, in fact, the Compton effect shows this, that when atom is bombarded by radiation, a positively charged ion and a negatively charged ion is produced. And this is the characteristics ability of the ionizing radiations, that is the such type of radiations which, when they interact with the material and produce ions, maybe positive ion or negative ions, they are called ionizing radiations. These ionizing radiations, as I told you, interact with an inner irradiated material by transferring the energy to electrons, and these electrons, they, after getting the energy, get raised to a high energy or excited state. And if the transferred energy is large enough, the negatively charged electron can leave a molecule, and therefore, it gives a positive ion. The irradiation creates about one ionization for every two excitations, but because the ionizations are about 1000 times as likely to cause chemical changes, the biological effects caused by the radiations are almost entirely due to this ionization effect. The ejected electron moves through surrounding materials and loses its energy by creating further excited and positive ions. Eventually, in the process, the electron is captured by a positive ion and is trapped by a structure to form a negative ion, which in turn combines with a positive ion. And it is this ability of ionizing radiations to create positive and negative ions is its characteristic, and it is used for beneficial purposes in food processing operations. There are several types of ionizing radiations. It may be electromagnetic radiation, is a gamma rays and X rays. Gamma rays are generally produced by decay of certain radioactive elements like cobalt 60. They have range of energies. X rays, they can be produced by a fast moving particle such as electrons, etcetera, when they are bombarded unsuitable target materials, then these are produced and they have range of energies. The other type of ionizing radiations may be particulate radiations like electrons, alpha particles, protons and neutrons, etcetera. And the energy values contained in these electromagnetic radiations, particularly gamma rays and X rays, are of such magnitude that for every ionization, that is, once it creates ionization, once it comes in contact with the food material, there are, for every primary ionization, there are secondary ionization, tertiary ionization, etcetera. And the biological effect that is obtained in the food materials, that is mainly because of the secondary ionization and tertiary ionization, etcetera, not much because of the absorbed energy. That is, absorbed energy, it causes the ionization, but other chemical effects in the food constituents and other things are because of the secondary ion, the secondary and tertiary ions which are produced due to this irradiation process. The gamma rays, X rays and beta rays, they can travel into the mass to little deeper because of their mass, they can go deep into the, they can penetrate deep into the material and therefore, they have low linear energy transfer. Linear energy transfer, that is called LET value, is that measure of the energy per distance traveled in the biological materials. So, since whatever the energy they are containing, it is dissipated over a long path because they can penetrate deep into the materials. So, the per distance energy dissipated is low. So, they are characterized by having low LET and low LET, therefore, is partially ionizing. On the other hand, the alpha particles, protons, etcetera, because of their high mass, they are frequently stopped by the biological materials and they are not able to penetrate deep into the materials. And due to this, the energy is dissipated over a small path and therefore, that is, they have high LET value, and high LET value means they are densely ionizing. So, these are the characteristics of these ionizing radiations, which becomes beneficial in the process optimization purposes. In this slide, you can see the radiation spectrum, which is normally used in regard to the frequency of the waves per second or energy of one photon, and the radiations which are used for food processing like X rays, gamma rays, etcetera, normally towards the higher side, that is having 10 to the power 16 and more, that is a frequency waves per second. Regarding the unit of measurement, we like to define the dose of the radiation received by the food materials, because this becomes an important consideration in analyzing the food irradiation processes, that is, what is the amount of dose that is required for a particular operation, for a particular purpose. So, the dose is the quantity of radiation absorbed by the food. And the unit, which is normally, in fact, it is a older unit in the through older age in the food process operations, just to discuss or say that unit of measurement of radiation is generally used was rad. Rad is radiation absorbed dose, and 1 rad equals the deposition of 100 ergs per gram in the irradiated sample. Since that there are certain some microorganism in some food process operations, that is they require that is little higher energy, particularly when the microorganisms etcetera in a, their inactivation or killing are involved. So, expressing this in terms of rad was becoming little higher, showing their little higher value. So, and recently an another unit was introduced, that is gray. 1 gray is equal to 100 rad. So, in this, so that units become little, but it is almost the same. In this slide, I have tried to show you that what is the effect of radiation on living organism, and they are lethal, that is they have lethal effect radiations, and potential lethal effect of radiations was realized soon after the discovery of X-rays by Roentgen and radioactivity by Becquerel in the late 19th century. And it was established that the dose of radiation required to produce a lethal effect varies with the complexity of the organism. The most complex organisms tend to be most sensitive to radiation, and which you can see in this line diagram. That is, while the human beings, which are considered to be the most complex systems, biological material, they can be destroyed or they can be killed only by the exposure to a few hundreds of rads, whereas some sterilization of some microorganism, single cell microorganisms, etcetera, it requires millions or millions of rad, that is 10^7. So, the most complex is the system, or most complex is the biological system, it is more sensitive to ionizing radiations. Now, let us see how does this ionizing radiation work. So, there are 2 mechanisms of their action have been proposed. One is the direct action mechanism, another is the indirect action mechanism. In the direct action mechanism, it is assumed that it is said that the radiation, it directly hits the target, that is maybe the genetic materials or DNA etcetera of the molecule. So, the chemical events are there as a result of the energy deposition on the target molecule DNA etcetera, and this theory is applicable, that is showed by the on the microorganisms etcetera, which are single cell microorganisms, single cell, and the microbial, that is destruction kinetics of the microorganisms etcetera through radiations, it is explains this or fits into this mechanism. But this mechanism, this direct action mechanism, does not hold true for the multicellular organisms. If unless we assume that these multicellular organisms are a single entity, but in this case the indirect action mechanism appears to be more correct, where radicals are formed from the maybe either by radiolysis of the water or the reactions originating outside the cells. That is radiation, that is radiations, they hit not the target molecule, but they do their effect outside the cell and then it ultimately affects maybe that ionization etcetera, which you could see. And this multicellular organism, they get destroyed by indirect action mechanism. Now, of course, that is electrons disrupt the DNA chain, either destroy or prevent reproduction of the organisms, and the living cells, like they cause sprouting and spoilage, in the biological material, etcetera, food, etcetera, they get expelled by microbial action or by enzymatic process. Also, that is the physiological process in certain fruits and vegetables result to their sprouting, which is not desirable for their good quality. So, this DNA damage also may delay the spoilage, or it may prevent the sprouting, it may promote longer shelf life, etcetera. So, this is the way how these ionizing radiations work on the food systems or on the biological material and do their job. So, let us see technological aspect of the irradiation. As you can see in this picture, that is here, that this sample of the food material, packaged or unpackaged, is taken to through appropriate means to a source of radiation. Alright, means that is in the in this technology is that food is exposed to control energy, that is ionizing radiations, and the normal types of ionizing radiations which are used in food processing are gamma rays, produced normally from cobalt 60 source, X rays with energies up to 5 milli equivalent volt, and electrons up to 10 MeV. And these radiations, ionizing radiations, they kill microorganisms, they inactivate proteins, enzymes, or they destroy other causative agents or inhibitory factors to spoilage without raising the temperature of the food. Okay. Means that it is considered to be a cold process, non-thermal process. However, one has to take care the contamination can occur post treatment. So, after the food material is exposed to the irradiation, one must properly take care, that is the it should not come again in contact with microorganisms, etc. So, recontamination should be avoided. Otherwise, the whole purpose of the process will be defeated. The different dosages, depending upon the requirement of the process, depending upon actually what is the objective of the process, different dosages are given to the food material, and accordingly the processes are given different names. Like in the case of thermal processing, in the thermal processing we have pasteurization process and sterilization process or blanching process, depending upon the intensity of the heat given to food material. Similarly, here we have red apertization, radurization, and radicidation. Red apertization, you can say that it is a radiation sterilization, that is complete removal of the microorganisms or biological forms of the causative agents is targeted here. So, obviously, this process needs a higher dose, maybe to the tune of 4.5 million rad or even more. It sterilizes the food by killing the bacteria, viruses, etcetera, and in the low acid food or in the other foods, here also that is this process normally is based on the destruction kinetics of the spores of Clostridium botulinum. However, this may be specific to different foods, their low acid food, like that acidity classification and other things which are applicable in thermal processing, similar type of things are applicable here also. Radurization is the radiation pasteurization. Of course, it needs medium dose, maybe to the tune of 100 to 1000 kilorad, and here that is about 90% destruction of the organism of some type only, that is the pathogenic microorganisms that are only spoilage by disease causing bacteria or microorganisms may be targeted, or that is the processes like sprouting, fruit ripening, etcetera, may take place in this dose, and of course, the insects can be inactivated. The other term is the radiation, which is a comparatively lower dose, particularly maybe in the range of 400 to 600 kilorad. It kills most pathogens and many food spoilage organisms, insects and parasites, and in fact it is very suitable process. That is, radiation is basically targeted towards the killing of the salmonella, and which is a food poisoning microorganism which more frequently affects that poultry and poultry bird or eggs, etcetera. So, it is used, there is low dose irradiation can be used to sterilize or to kill salmonella in poultry or eggs, etcetera, and make it more suitable. Okay. Now, we saw in earlier slide, also we discussed earlier that this ionizing radiations or irradiation of food can prevent food poisoning by killing pathogenic or toxin producing microorganism like E. coli, salmonella, campylobacter, parasites, etcetera. It can prevent spoilage of the food materials by destroying molds, bacteria, yeast, etcetera. It controls insects and parasite infestation. It increases shelf life by slowing down the ripening of fresh fruits and vegetables. Means it has got several beneficial effects. Of course, we will take up this issue again in the second part of the lecture, little in detail, that is application of the irradiation on food. So, another important consideration is how to stabilize, that is establishing radiation stabilization process for food. So, means that is the, so that the food becomes room temperature stable, its all the biological processes which are deteriorative processes are stopped. So, obviously, as in the case of any process, even in the heat treatment, etcetera, is that the food may be stabilized by inactivating the microorganisms and enzymes, or in a broader sense, that is the causative or biological and other factors which cause spoilage or food or produce toxin in food, and then more importantly protecting the stabilized food from recontamination and their access to oxygen. That is, once they are treated with the ionizing radiations, proper care should be taken that post treatment they are not again exposed to contaminated environment, or they are not exposed to oxygen environment, oxygen rich environment, otherwise oxidative reactions and other reactions may take place there, and they may again, that is, the spoil the food. So, the stabilization of food with ionizing radiations accordingly involves two major considerations. Number one, that is the characteristics of the food, and number two, that is a suitable source of radiation. That is the characteristic of the food, that is its acidity, its moisture content, its other components present in the polymers, etcetera, in the form in which that macromolecules and other things are present, that in fact decides or that dictates that what type of microorganism will grow in a particular food or which will not grow. So, that the on the basis of the food characteristics, we try it the data of the food and its information about microorganisms and other things which we it can support is needed to establish that yes, the process, radiation process, that is how much energy is radiation energy is required to be given for a specific purpose. So, the food characteristics were, and then other things suitable radiation source, that obviously that is you should have a good source for to produce the radiation or ionizing radiation. Regarding the food characteristics, obviously, suppose a process is based on the destruction of microorganism, So, microbial death kinetics are, in other words, if it is on the based on the enzymes, the enzymatic death kinetics etcetera is to be considered, all right. So, the death of the microorganism basically when exposed to radiation can be evaluated by plotting logarithm of the fraction of surviving organisms against dose, as in the case of a thermal processing also the similar things we do here. And we can see here in this plot that ln n by n 0 when plotted against dose in the red, it gives a linear relationship. It means that for a given dose, for equal doses, the microbial population is decreased by a given factor. In this equation, n is equal to n 0 e to the power minus d by d 0, n is the number of live organisms after the irradiation, n 0 is the initial number of organisms present in the food material, d is the dose of radiation received by the food, d 0 is the constant depending upon the type of the organism and environmental factor, all right, and it is generally considered to be the factor that which radiation dose which causes 63% death or death of the 63% of the organism available. Of course, depending upon the process, several other factors can also be considered like D10 value, a value causing a reduction in number of factor of microorganism reduction by a factor of 10. Then there is to decide the dose given, we need to understand that how, what are the different factor that affect or that influence the radiation sensitivity of the microorganisms. And both, and you can see here that both the environmental factor as well as the physiological and genetic differences between the strains and cultures of microorganism can affect the its radiation sensitivity. The major factors in this regard include type of the radiation, dose rate, presence or absence of oxygen in the irradiating medium, state of the food and temperature. As far as the type of the radiation is concerned, it has no significant effect on the dose response. It is immaterial whether the irradiation is given in the form of, or radiation energy is given in the form of electrons or X-rays or gamma rays. At least required amount of energy has to be given, right, to the food for the desired use. Regarding dose rate, that is the intensity of the radiation, again amount of the radiation absorbed by the cell per unit time, it is the dose rate, and it again does not seem to have affect the sensitivity. That is, required amount of energy has to be given to the material for getting desired output, right, whether it is given at a fast rate or it is given at a slow rate measurement. Of course, it might influence the other environmental factors like, for example, there is the increase in the temperature etcetera during radiation. Presence of oxygen again does not have a significant effect on the microbial sensitivity or the microbial requirement or its influence process of killing by the microorganism, as the pH and the type of medium in which the microorganisms are irradiated do. Okay. However, the oxygen presence absence of oxygen may have other influence on the other chemical reactions. State of the food in which it is irradiated, it does that is irradiation in the dehydrated form may be beneficial. Irradiation in the frozen state reduces radio sensitivity of some microorganisms. So, sterilization of food in the frozen state may require little greater dose, but it minimizes the chemical and other flavor changes in the food. As far as the temperature is concerned, it has effect on the sterilization requirement, and this effect, that is effect of temperature on the radiosensitivity of microorganisms, are forms the basis of the potential combination processes utilizing both heat and radiation, because there are certain agents, microorganisms and enzymes, certain microorganisms are more sensitive to irradiation, but stable to heat and vice versa. So, a suitable process, that is a process can be combined, that is the give a low heat treatment and followed by irradiation, or radiation treatment followed by heat treatment, etcetera, can be given to have the beneficial effect. And at the same time, if you use very high temperature, it has its, it adds its own effects or own lethal effects into the food component. Regarding food irradiation sources, there are normally two types of sources. One is the radioisotope source, another we will see in the next slide is the machine source. In the radioisotope source, presently commonly, that is most commonly, the cobalt 60 radioisotope is used. It emits two electrons, that is two radiations having energy value 1.33 and 1.17 MeV. It has half life of 5.27 years. It is produced in a plaque source consisting of flat strips, which may contain more than 10,000 curie per strip, and several such strips can be assembled together in maybe and wafer, steel wafers or other such materials, wafer that they can put, and that is number of strips are assembled by remote controlled operations, and the source is immersed in deep foot, that is maybe 25 feet or more deep storage pool of water when not in use, and this is just to prevent the escape of radiation into the environment, etcetera. So, cobalt 60 is used presently, but cesium 137 can also be used, it has also good potential for application in food processing. The other machine sources, there are several types of linear accelerators which have been produced. We can generate electrons, etcetera, which that is they can generate beta rays or X rays, right. And these, of course, they are machine sources, they produce no waste outside the machine, which is used to produce these radiations. And here, as you could see in these two picture diagrams, that is electron is accelerated by an electron gun similar to a TV tube, accelerating the electrons towards the screen, and it can be turned on and off when not in use or when to be used. And electron beams can only penetrate about, of course, little, that is 1 inch into the material. Here you see that the working principle of two commonly used accelerators like linear accelerator and electrostatic accelerator is shown here in this. In the case of electrostatic accelerator, electron flow through a high voltage terminal, they come down to high vacuum discharge tube and they are accelerated, finally they are scanned to cover a target area. So, you can see here, that is the when the food is coming, it will show in the next slide how the when the food comes, it will be exposed over this area. In the linear accelerators, electron pulse, they is accelerated as it moves downwards, right, and it is trapped in waveguide, it is accelerated and electrons move through the with the higher velocities, and it is trapped with the radio frequency accelerators are also provided. So, in this case also, that is it is scanned finally through the scanner to cover the uniform area. In this slide, I have already covered, but it gives a comparison of the two, that is the sources that is commonly used like cobalt 60 source, electron beam and X-rays, that is cobalt 60, it has a high penetrating power, permanent radioactive source, high efficiency source replacement needed after some time, and when this energy and then low throughput. Whereas the electron beams or X-rays, they have the electron beams has low penetrating power, it has the switch on switch off capability, it has high efficiency, high throughput, power and cooling is needed, and technically complex process little bit. X-rays have high penetrating power, switch on switch off capability is here also, they have comparatively low efficiency, high throughput and power and cooling needed, and of course, it is also like electron beams, technically that is complex process. So, in this it is a, you see there is a pictorial presentation, it shows a gamma irradiation facility, that is for the food irradiation. See here, that is it is a gamma irradiation means cobalt 62, and it is kept here in the storage, in the deep storage pool of the water, and there are all, that is conveying system, the food material depending upon the type material in the packaged form or even unpackaged form also can be exposed to the irradiation. So, this is the loading area. So, the food is in the packaged form or unpackaged form, it is loaded depending upon the requirement, and it goes through those, it comes here into the. So, that is here your irradiation room chamber is this, and this material passes, there are seals, radiation seals at different layers of, that is the of the concrete walls, when it takes a zigzag route or chest route, just to make sure that the radiation is not leaked to the environment. So, this now depending upon the type of the food, depending upon the requirement of the process, that is the speed of the conveyor belt, that is controlled. To when it comes here by a remote control operation, that is the this source, radiation source comes above the water, and this energy is given, that is gamma rays are exposed, that food is exposed to the gamma rays, all right. And here in this, it is towards the target area. So, there are impact systems where again there is this food can be exposed from both sides to the gamma ray, and after it is exposed, after it is given the desired energy for the required operation, again it returns back and comes, it is unloaded in this. So, this makes that this is basically actually the technological, how this technology and how in the industry and commercially how this process is applied. Okay. This slide gives you, that is what are the foods that can be irradiated, and of course, the dose and purpose, like low dose may be less than 1 k gray kilo gray can be used for sprouting inhibition, insect and parasite infestation, delay in ripening, and all these in the case of potatoes, onions, garlic, cereals, pulses, dried fruit, pork, etcetera. Medium dose may be 1 to 10 kilo gray can be used for reduction of his spoilage of his strawberries, reduction of non spore pathogens in poultry and shellfish, or maybe 7 to 10 kilo gray can be used for microbial reduction in dry products like herbs and spices. Of course, high dose or very high dose, that is particularly for sterilization purposes or for elimination of viruses or viral contamination, etcetera, particularly to produce sterile diet meals and army rations, etcetera, maybe towards the 25 to 50 or 10 to 100 kilo gray can be used. So, friends, well, so by now I think we have seen that what are the different types of ionizing radiations, for what purposes they can be used into the food, what are the different dosages, and how it actually works, the sources of the how can these ionizing radiations can be produced, and at least some hint we have given to you how these processes etcetera can be optimized, and depending upon the requirement, that is one has to take care that the process has to be optimized so that we get maximum destruction of the causative agents with maximum retention of the food characteristics. In the next part of the lecture, we will see the effect of these radiations on food constituents, and we will also take up a few examples on its food application. Thank you.